Coverage of a House subcommittee hearing on telephone solicitation. Back in April, the House Energy and Commerce Subcommittee on Telecommunications held a hearing on two bills that proposed to regulate certain types of telemarketing practices and put a limit on the use of caller identification technologies. At this hearing, representatives from the telemarketing industry and from various consumer organizations expressed their views on H.R. 1304, the proposed Telephone Advertising Consumer Rights Act, and H.R. 1305, the proposed Telephone Consumer Privacy Act. Massachusetts Representative Edward Markey, chairman of the Telecommunications Subcommittee, presided over the hearing. Congressman Markey and New Jersey Representative Matthew Rinaldo, the ranking Republican member of the subcommittee, were co-sponsors of the telephone advertising bill.
Apologize for the movement. Session might have been in session tomorrow.
I'm going to give the chairman some more.
Good morning. First of all, let me begin by apologizing to all of you for the change in the venue, all of it due to circumstances beyond our control, but we very much appreciate your cooperation this morning. Today the subcommittee will hold a legislative hearing on H.R. 1304, the Telephone Advertising and Consumer Rights Act, and H.R. 1305, the Telephone Consumer Privacy Rights Act. These two complementary pieces of legislation have been introduced to curb unsolicited electronic advertising and telemarketing, as well as to restore the important balance in personal privacy that has been skewed by some offerings of caller ID and some uses of automatic number identification. Now, unsolicited electronic advertising is one of the unforeseen consequences of the modern telecommunications revolution. The information age equivalents of the door-to-door salesman of yesteryear are plying their wares through the wires these days. These new telemarketing techniques are not only pervasive, but also more intrusive than ever before. Unsolicited calls have become a nightly ritual for many consumers, and many complain bitterly that these junk calls from strangers and robots are an invasion of their privacy. Some telemarketing technologies, such as automatic dialing machines, can dial up to 1,000 homes per day to deliver a pre-recorded or live message. These machines place calls randomly, meaning they sometimes call unlisted numbers or numbers for hospitals, police, and fire stations, causing public safety problems. In addition, more than 3 million fax machines in this country will transmit and receive more than 40 billion pages of information this year. According to industry officials, each day these machines are used by more than 180,000 solicitors to call more than 7 million Americans. H.R. 1304, introduced by Congressman Rinaldo and myself, and which presently has 35 co-sponsors, is legislation that will finally give the public an opportunity to just say no to unsolicited phone or facsimile advertisements. Individuals and business subscribers who object to unwanted telephone solicitations would be able to make their telephone numbers off limits to telephone telemarketers by placing these numbers in a restricted electronic database. Our bill also would prohibit advertising calls to public safety numbers, as well as to paging and cellular equipment. The aim of this legislation is not to eliminate telemarketing or attack new technologies, but rather to secure an individual's right to privacy that might be unintentionally intruded upon by these new technologies or marketing techniques. The reason for the proliferation of such unsolicited advertising over our nation's telecommunications network is that companies can now target their marketing to individual home phone numbers or business fax machines. The reason why these unsolicited telemarketers can target individual homes is simple. Corporate America has your number. You may not have been aware of it, but whenever you call an 800 or 900 number, or even a local business, new phone technologies may be collecting your name, your address, and your phone number, and you are powerless to stop it. New technologies from caller ID to automatic number identification used by 800 and 900 number services mean that your home phone number can be easily accessed over phone lines. These numbers can then be matched to your name and address through the use of reverse directories, opening the door to even greater information, transactions, buying habits, movements, even information about hobbies. These personal information tidbits are subsequently manipulated by computers to produce highly sophisticated and possibly intrusive personal socioeconomic data. These data are then compiled into lists, which are then bought or sold without restriction. According to a recent Wall Street Journal article, the business of buying and selling these lists is indeed big business, with each of the three largest purveyors raking in between $150 and $250 million yearly. The American public has expressed widespread concern with threats to personal privacy. Last year, a survey conducted by Lewis Harris and Associates showed an overwhelming 79% to 19% margin. Americans agreed that if we rewrote the Declaration of Independence today, we would probably add privacy to the list of life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness as a fundamental right. And by a 71% to 27% margin in that same Harris survey, Americans subscribe to the view that consumers have lost control over how personal information is circulated and used by companies. I feel strongly that each and every American, whether using the telephone for a personal or business transaction, should have complete control over the personal or private information that may be derived from telephone services such as caller ID and automatic number identification. Whether a new technology or service is popular among some subscribers or useful to American business is irrelevant when the debate centers around the technological infringement of personal privacy. As a bottom line, consumers should be no worse off after the introduction of a new technology than they were before the introduction of that technology. H.R. 1305, Telephone Consumer Privacy Rights Act, was introduced to address the fundamental ways in which personal privacy may be threatened by new telecommunications technology. The legislation would require phone companies to allow callers to continue to protect their personal telephone numbers by withholding on a per-call basis the disclosure of their telephone number to those they are calling. This is of special concern to those telephone subscribers who have paid their telephone company for an unlisted telephone number, only to realize that this same telephone company is now selling their unlisted number to all comers, anyone willing to pay for caller ID. The bill also would prohibit corporate America's reuse or resale of personal information gathered over the telephone network without the affirmative consent of the consumer. This legislation is not meant to outlaw caller ID or ANI, but it will help to ensure that enhanced service offerings don't become the equivalent of a joint venture between Ma Bell, the Baby Bells, and Big Brother. Enhanced telecommunications technologies like these can be exciting new additions to our telecommunications offerings. I feel that we should actively encourage their development and deployment while also seeking to ensure that they truly serve the interests of the public. Today, we will listen to testimony from consumer representatives and industry spokespersons, and we will start by hearing testimony from the Honorable Jolene Unsold, who has been a leader in highlighting the often intrusive nature of telemarketing techniques, such as auto dialers, and has introduced legislation in this area. But before we do that, we're first going to hear from the ranking minority member on the subcommittee, and a gentleman from New Jersey, Congressman Matt Rinaldo.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I want to commend you for calling this important hearing, and I want to welcome our colleague, Jolene Unsold, and commend the interest and role that she has taken in addressing the important issues we'll face today. The telephone and telecommunications are an essential part of American life. In many ways, the telephone is a lifeline for both business and the average citizen. But the telephone is increasingly a means of commerce. And as we will hear today, potential abuses and invasions of privacy are increasingly real threats for all of us. Today, the subcommittee will look at problems that have received attention from the public and from Congress. The use of automatic dialing machines or auto dialers, the unauthorized sending of advertisements through fax machines, and the deployment and use of automatic number identification and a related service known as caller ID. Auto dialers typically call homes and play recorded advertising messages as many as 1,000 telephone numbers per day. That's not only a nuisance, but a potential danger if an auto dialer does not disconnect, as some apparently do not, while calling a hospital or other emergency health and safety-related service. Another frustrating problem has arisen from so-called junk fax. Junk fax is more than merely irritating. It represents an unfair shifting of the cost of advertising from the advertiser to the unwitting customer. Also, like auto dialers, unsolicited and unwanted faxes can tie up a machine for hours and thwart the receipt of legitimate and important messages. The legislation Chairman Markey and I have introduced would bar unsolicited pre-recorded telephone messages and fax transmissions to any number which is on record as objecting to their receipt. It also prohibits unsolicited calls to emergency telephone lines at healthcare facilities and safety-related agencies. The bill, which is substantially similar to legislation passed by the House last year, is a narrowly tailored response to a problem which we cannot permit to grow out of control. It balances the First Amendment rights of those who wish to receive advertising through those mediums with those who do not wish to receive such advertising. Today, we will also address the privacy issues related to caller number identification. In my home state of New Jersey, the first state to offer caller ID, the number of abusive telephone calls reported to the telephone company since the advent of caller ID has dropped precipitously, by as much as 50%, according to some statistics offered to this committee. While I applaud the tremendous impact that caller ID has had on reducing abusive calls, the service does raise some very serious privacy concerns. We all recognize that there is a compelling basis for protecting by not revealing the telephone numbers of certain special groups of people, including those calling from domestic violence and rape crisis centers, and those involved in law enforcement, and particularly undercover activities. But there are other groups with privacy expectations as well. Customers who request and pay for unlisted telephone numbers, a monthly fee, have as compelling an expectation of privacy as those who request and pay for caller ID service. In New Jersey, roughly one-third of residential telephone subscribers have unlisted telephone numbers. They desire, they pay for, and they have a right to expect some anonymity as to their home telephone numbers. I believe that telephone subscribers who have an unlisted number have a right and reasonable expectation to seek to prevent the transmission of their telephone numbers to those subscribing to caller ID. In fact, it should be taken for granted. It should be automatic. They're paying to have their number protected. I do not believe any harm occurs to the privacy rights or expectations of persons being called by an individual exercising the option of blocking the telephone number. Anyone with caller ID who observes that the incoming call is from a blocked number may simply choose to not take the call. Thereby, that person preserves the right to have the privacy, to have the other person's privacy, that person's privacy invaded. To those who are concerned that allowing callers to block the called party's receipt of their numbers will lead to an increase in abusive calls, I would simply point out that there are other services, notably Call Trace, which act as a deterrent to such abuses. Call Trace is a service that provides the telephone number of an abusive caller through the telephone company to a law enforcement agency for appropriate legal action. Call Trace is a reasonably priced service that prudently involves law enforcement officials in handling cases that likely involve criminal activity. Thus, where caller ID is offered, I believe that in balancing the privacy expectations of the calling and called parties, caller ID should be offered in conjunction with free per-call blocking. Additionally, I believe very strongly that those with unlisted numbers should have the option to request per-line blocking, which automatically blocks the receipt of the caller's number. Finally, we will also address this morning abusive commercial practices that are growing fairly unabated through the use of automatic number identification. I do not believe that customers who call 800 and 900 numbers to inquire about or purchase a particular product or service expect or desire that their telephone number and other customer information will be divulged or even sold to other merchants. Unrestricted access by telemarketers to such customer information clearly could lead to the type of intrusive, unsolicited advertising practices that people are tired of and are asking Congress to address. So once again, I want to take this opportunity to commend Chairman Markey for his leadership in raising these issues and seeking fair, appropriate solutions. I look forward to receiving all of the witnesses' testimony and working with them and with the majority and other interested parties to craft meaningful and responsive legislation to address these problems, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentlemen's time has expired. We'll next recognize the gentleman from the state of Texas, Mr. Barton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to commend you and the Vice Chairman, Congressman Rinaldo, for holding this hearing. Very briefly, the first act that we're going to consider, H.R. 1304, appears to me to be noteworthy legislation. I would reserve the right to review some of the sections for possible amendments, but in general I support that. The Telephone Consumer Privacy Rights Act, H.R. 1305, I have to say that I, on the surface, am strongly opposed to the intent of that act. I have a publicly listed phone number at my home. I think as a public representative, the people need to be able to get in touch with me or have the right to get in touch with me. So I don't have an unlisted telephone number. As a consequence, I get an average of 3 to 4 anonymous / obscene phone calls a day. My wife feels very strongly that if the state of Texas would allow caller ID, that would be something that would be very useful. I can certainly understand the concerns of law enforcement and some of the rape crisis centers, and I think there might be a way to prevent those types of calls from being traced. But I have to say that if somebody walks up to my door and knocks on the door, I have a right to know who that person is before I let them into my home. By the same token, if somebody calls my home, I think I have the right, or any American citizen has the right, to know who is making that phone call. And so I will work in a very cooperative fashion on 1304. I reserve the right to try to retain the rights of the individual that are being harassed in H.R. 1305. And I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman's time has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from the state of Oklahoma, Mr. Siner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And let me let me first of all commend you for these hearings. This is an issue which is growing in importance and also interest throughout the country. In my own state of Oklahoma, we are beginning to get a tremendous amount of mail from citizens who are concerned about their privacy. As the member of this subcommittee, who also serves on the Judiciary Subcommittee on Intellectual Property and Copyrights, I have taken the advantage of being on both subcommittees to introduce my own legislation with regards to privacy. Our caller ID legislation that we've introduced would allow caller ID to be done within the jurisdictions of the various phone companies, but it also would allow the blocking decision to be made on a state-by-state basis. I look forward to working with this subcommittee, because this will be jointly referred, whatever the two subcommittees do, to coming up with a solution that will be satisfactory not only to the privacy of citizens, but also to protect the people who do want to have that kind of information not disbanded throughout the public. This is an important issue. In many ways, as we go past 1984, it seems now that we are really where many people anticipated we would be there. And it's important that the legislative body that we serve in take the opportunity to review this, to take the input that's necessary so that we can make good decisions.
Gentleman's time has expired. I look forward to working with the gentleman from Oklahoma. We clearly have to craft something that deals with all of these complex issues. Are there any other members seeking recognition for the purpose of making an opening statement at this time? The chair does not see any other members seeking recognition at this time. So we'll begin then with our first witness, Representative Jolene Unsold from the 3rd District of Washington, who has been an aggressive leader in this area in trying to find some accommodation between the intrusive technological problems which were found and the rights and privacy that individuals in our country are assumed to have. So welcome, Jolene. Whenever thank you're ready, please begin your testimony.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Actually, thank you for letting me follow the lead of you in this committee, because I think this is an area that the public is more and more going to want to have the protections that you're looking at. And I certainly support your well-crafted and carefully considered bill, and appreciate the lead that all of you are taking on this. Now, as you and I have discussed, I introduced the Telephone Privacy Act to combat one of the issues that you address in your comprehensive legislation, computer-generated calls, because my bill would outright ban the use of automatic dialing and announcing devices, ADADs, for commercial solicitation. In Washington State, when I was in the state legislature, we instituted this several years ago. The only flaw in it is that it cannot prevent calls coming from another state into Washington, which is why national legislation would be necessary. And of course, it couldn't give the Federal Communications Commission the power to fine violators in order to control the situation. I've heard from dozens of people who support this concept, Mr. Chairman, because people dislike telemarketing in general, and they're particularly infuriated when a machine invades the precious little time and privacy they enjoy at home. In addition, homebound, elderly, or disabled people are too often the primary targets of these intrusive machines, and they're too good to be true scams. I'm sure you've heard the horror stories also, Mr. Chairman. A doctor called on his beeper, returns the call, only to be offered a deal on diet pills and charged $3 for the call. In the aftermath of the devastating San Francisco earthquake, a man hears his phone ringing beneath the rubble of his home, answers it, finds himself listening to a computer sales pitch. Or the man in the hospital bed in the intensive care ward, a computer dialed him too, offering him a trip to Hawaii. And maybe most disturbing of all, the stories from people who have tried to hang up on these contraptions because they needed to make an emergency call, but the line was blocked. You probably have received a letter from someone who's in this business who claims that, contrary to my claim, The equipment, today's products, do disconnect upon called party hang-up, and that when was the last time your answering machine filled up with call this number now, call this number now? Mine has this year. And the latest horror story about it refusing to hang up was a woman who received such a call on her car phone, and not only would it not hang up, but it kept, of course, she was paying by the minute for this unsolicited intrusion. I will work with you, Mr. Chairman, to develop a way to protect Americans from these intrusions. I prefer my bill because it makes the telemarketers do the work. They must dispose of their machines that intrude upon 7 million Americans each day, and they must employ human beings who will make fewer privacy-invading calls. In your bill, the burden is on phone owners to protect themselves. They must know they can become off-limits to telemarketers. They must find the address. They must trust the government to protect them. However, I feel we must do something, and your bill provides a good compromise. Mr. Chairman, thank you for your excellent work. Let's get as comprehensive a bill as we can, as soon as we can, and I'll help however I can. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Do you think that the enforcement provisions in your bill are strong enough to accomplish the goals which you have?
We increase what is currently the type of current fine that would be possible, and I believe it is, but it could always be raised in the future.
And the reason that you've decided to introduce this legislation at the national level, even though it has already been in place in Washington State for the last several years, is that it still cannot control the interstate calls.
Correct. And I believe that those who are engaged in this kind of telemarketing probably have a single location and can reach across the United States anywhere. Mm-hmm. So it requires national legislation to address this. The issue has also been raised about freedom of speech and whether a total ban is appropriate, but my reading of the Constitution does not bestow that right upon computers. They may be pretty smart, but they haven't gotten that right.
I don't have any other questions at this time. Do any other members have any questions of Congresswoman?
Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Jolene, very much. Let's move then to our second panel, which consists of Mr. Mark Cooper, Research Director for the Consumer Federation of America, Mr. Jack Shreve, Public Counsel from the state of Florida, Mr. Tom Beard, Chairman of the Public Service Commission of the state of Florida, and Ms. Jen-Laurie Goldman, Director of the Privacy and Technology Project from the American Civil Liberties Union, along with Mr. Mark Rottenberg, Director of the Computer Professionals for Social Responsibility. Okay. We have a logistical problem this morning in that we are only able to use this room for another hour and 25 minutes, and we have yet another panel to hear from as well, in addition to the questions from the members of the subcommittee. So we have historically had a 5-minute rule in terms of statements from witnesses, and because of the time restraints which we have, we're going to enforce that very strictly. Would ask for your cooperation from the outset. So let's begin with you, Mr. Beard, if we could. Please try to abide by the 5-minute restriction.
Thank you. If I take 5 minutes, I will be excessively wordy. We have filed on behalf of NARUC, has filed on my behalf and on behalf of NARUC complete comments with supporting documentation.
Can you move that microphone in just a little bit closer?
Yes, sir. Is that better? And I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman, and the members of the committee for the opportunity to be here, and especially thank you for taking up this these topics, and primarily the issue of privacy. I'll be brief. One of the primary concerns that I think we have with ADADs and junk facts is, as expressed earlier, it ties up your and my telephone line. It forces me to print the advertising of someone else in the case of junk fax, and basically is an expense that I as an individual would incur that I otherwise would choose not to. On a personal level, I am the telemarketing bottleneck at my home, and when someone calls, they hand me the phone and the conversation is fairly brief and it's over with. I can't do that with a recording. I can't shut it off. I can't make it stop. And I think that is a primary concern. And the same thing with junk fax as it comes across, and it creates a bottleneck in and of itself. With respect to caller ID and the privacy issues, Florida has taken a position. NARUC has not, and I cannot speak for NARUC in that sense. Florida just recently had hearings and had a ruling on that. We did approve caller ID with free per-call blocking. We allowed per-line blocking for law enforcement and certain social abuse-type agencies where that was of paramount concern. It was a fairly drastic move. I was originally in the same position as Congressman Barton in that I felt strongly about caller ID with no blocking. After extensive hearings traveling throughout Florida and getting an opportunity to hear the people, I can tell you that 100% of the people of Florida, at least, and probably this nation, want to be able to, in every instance, receive the number of who's calling them, but in every instance, not allow their number to be transmitted. Unfortunately, that technology, I don't think, can ever be invented. Therefore, you've got to try and balance those privacy rights. And in Florida, we found that the free per-call blocking seemed to be the logical balance. In going through those hearings, I kept an actual score pad of each of the people that came forward, and there was just about a 50-50 balance in each instance of those that favored caller ID versus those that opposed it. And in most cases, a reasonable compromise appeared to be per-call blocking. I can tell you from having faced the people right out on the streets in those hearings, it's extremely controversial and it's an extremely personal issue. And I commend you for taking this on because it's not an easy subject to deal with. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Beard. You're good for your word, which were only 2 minutes and 15 seconds worth of them. And we appreciate your conciseness. Our next witness, Mr. Mark Cooper, Research Director of the Consumer Federation of America. Welcome back, Mark.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We believe that there are two principles that should guide this nation's policy with respect to the generation and use of information. The first principle can be simplified and expressed by making an analogy to environmental policy, one which I think you will appreciate. In environmental policy, we consciously choose not to pursue every economic opportunity when we feel there is damage to the environment. We forego drilling in some places, we forego burning some fuels, we impose cleanup requirements, waste reduction requirements, even though they're costly or difficult, because we judge the social and external costs to be too great. I suggest that we should not pollute our psychic environment either. We should not destroy our personal sense of privacy in pursuit of every potential economic advantage. Now, this first principle, which is straightforward, leads to a practical implementation principle. Pass only that information which is absolutely essential to accomplishing the task, if it's an important task for society. If a service or business does not absolutely need my personal information, it should not have it unless I explicitly and consciously want the information passed. And the act of preventing the passage of information should not cost me time, money, or otherwise burden me. For example, in order for an 800 number provider to do his business, he may need some billing information about the call. But the billing characteristics of a call are the time of day, day of week, area code, and exchange, not the entire telephone number. Withholding the last 4 digits is the key to protecting my privacy while allowing him to do his thing. If he wants my telephone number, the whole thing, let him ask me for it, and I might or might not give it to him. Similarly, we are repeatedly told that caller ID will help clean up the network, and that is certainly a useful and important social function. But should we give up the control over our telephone numbers in order to achieve that? We think not. We do not accept unreasonable search and seizure to end crime. We have rights, and we want to protect them. The troublesome thing about caller ID is that there shouldn't even be this dilemma. There is another technology out there that can do the job, as Mr. Rinaldo mentioned automatic call trace. Unfortunately, the telephone companies don't like automatic call trace because they can't make as much money on it. So what they've done is destroyed, undermined significantly, the socially correct and economically efficient way to handle the problem. They don't advertise it. They misprice it in some places. Some places they don't even offer it. Now, that caller ID call trace example is very important to this committee because it shows that this is not a matter of technological progress versus technological fear. Both alternatives are real progress. The issue is how to configure technology to best meet the public interest. Whenever a techie says, we can do this, therefore progress demands that we should do it, decision makers must ask, what values does this so-called progress create, and what values does it destroy? Personal privacy is not one of the values that we should give up to have the information age. Now, automatic number identification and caller ID present problems that are complex, sufficiently complex to require careful analysis. Junk fax and auto dialers are pure pollution. They are the information age equivalent of slash and burn agriculture. They create very little of economic value and a great deal of environmental pollution. ANI, caller ID, auto dialers, junk faxes are just the tip of the iceberg. There are an infinite array of potential privacy-depriving services that are coming down the pike. I've been in 10 caller ID cases, and I've seen constant references to larger files, all manner of databases, once they have my phone number. I believe it is critical that we clearly establish our commitment to protecting privacy right here on these simple issues before we get to the more complex ones. We applaud you for introducing this legislation. I especially applaud Mr. Rinaldo for looking past the rhetoric in his own state and taking a hard look at the balance of social costs and benefits around these services. The protection of consumer privacy must be the cornerstone on which the information age is built. Saving a second or a minute on a transaction would be very small gain if it costs us control of our telephone numbers and other vital pieces of personal information. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Cooper. Our next witness, Mr. Mark Rottenberg, is the director of the Computer Professionals for Social Responsibility. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd also like to thank you, Mr. Rinaldo, and Mr. Sinar for your work in support of consumer privacy. My name is Mark Rottenberg. I'm the director of a membership organization called CPSR. We are a group of computer professionals across the country who are particularly concerned, as Mark Cooper said a moment ago, that there be a fair weighing of the costs and benefits of new technologies.
Could you move up the microphone just a little bit closer, please?
We have looked in particular at the caller ID service because of the significant privacy issues that are raised. We believe that caller ID is directly at odds with established legal and ethical standards of privacy protection. Caller ID would transfer the right to control the disclosure of personal information from the individual, the telephone subscriber, to the institution, the telephone company. Then, only those phone subscribers who subscribed to the service would receive its benefits. Phone subscribers who did not pay the fee would not receive the incoming line number. However, all phone subscribers would effectively be required to turn over control of their telephone number to the phone company. Taken as a whole, there would be a net privacy loss. From a consumer viewpoint, caller ID is also a poorly conceived service. Caller ID provides residential call subscribers with only the number of the calling line. This is obviously less useful information than the identity of the caller or the reason for the call. However, telephone numbers are useful to large organizations that can link the incoming number to reverse directories and third-party information services, providing an elaborate dossier of the calling party. Moreover, the safety features of caller ID have been greatly overstated. It is easy to defeat the call locating capability of caller ID, and to place a call from a pay phone, through an operator, from a stranger's phone, or even through a private service. Nor is it clear that caller ID provides any benefit that is not currently provided by the less expensive and less intrusive telephone answering machine. There is no reason that the privacy interests of the call originator and the call recipient cannot both be accommodated. Call originators should have the right to decide when to give out their telephone numbers. Call recipients should have the right to decide whether to accept calls from people who do not disclose their phone numbers. The Telephone Consumer Privacy Rights Act and similar legislation before both the House and the Senate are a step in the right direction, but they do not go far enough. Consumers want strong privacy protection safeguards. They will not be satisfied with stopgap measures that require them to take additional steps to protect privacy. In fact, the recent poll by Lou Harris Associates found that more consumers believe that caller ID should be prohibited altogether than offered without call blocking. No telephone number should be disclosed without the knowledge and the consent of the phone user, except in emergency circumstances. If a person does nothing, subscribes to no new service, selects no new feature, his or her current expectation of privacy should remain unchanged. That is the threshold test for evaluating the impact of this new service on privacy. Therefore, CPSR recommends the following changes in the Telephone Privacy Act. First, callers should be entitled to free per-line blocking. Such blocking should remain the default setting until the consumer decides to change it. Second, notification provisions should not be read as a stopgap measure for real privacy protection. Informing a car driver that the brakes in his or her car are less secure should result in the recall of the car, not requiring that the driver make less frequent use of the brakes. Third, the waiver provision in the bill that permits the offering of a service that would otherwise be prohibited by law should be removed. Congress should not rely on the representation of a regulated industry to decide whether the application of a law is feasible. This determination must be made by an independent agency. I should say that CPSR will take no position on the Telephone Advertising Consumer Rights Act. We recognize that there is widespread opposition to junk faxes and auto dialers, and in some cases, even public safety concerns. However, we believe that a flat prohibition on unsolicited advertising may have a chilling effect on free speech, particularly in computer network environments where the ability to manage unsolicited messages may be much greater than most users of telephones and fax machines are aware. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Rotenberg. Thank you. Our next witness, Ms. Jalori Goldman, is Director of Privacy and Technology Project of the American Civil Liberties Union. Welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you for giving us the chance to testify here today on these two bills.
Could you move the microphone up? Move the microphone up a little bit closer. Thank you.
The ACLU supports the bills here today, one that would restrict the use of caller ID and ANI, and one that would create a limit or at least a database allowing people to opt out of certain commercial telephone calls. What we'd like to talk about for just a moment is the privacy interest here. In any situation in which we're looking at the impact of new technology on individuals, we have to balance the First Amendment rights and the privacy rights against the societal interest. With caller ID, what we have found is that there is a privacy interest of the person receiving the call. And in this situation with allowing blocking, what you're doing is you're saying to people, yes, you have an interest in receiving the number in your home. If someone doesn't want to give it to you, they should be able to block. We've even found that blocking gives more information to the person on the receiving end, not less. It can be a signal to somebody that the person calling does not want to let you know who it is, and you can then decide not to even answer the phone. I think that one of the arguments that's been made about how blocking will encourage harassing calls and abusive calls really is very, very misleading. And as I said, it can allow people who have been receiving those harassing and abusing calls to not even answer the phone. You know, the telephone company used to tell people to just hang up. Somehow that's changed. The privacy interest here is very clear, which is that people need to be able to maintain some control over the personal information that they give to others in the course of doing business with them, in the course of using the telephone. And without that control, people have really lost the very important central privacy right that they have. In the second bill, 1305, the ACLU was very concerned about the First Amendment issues here. And as you know, we have a very strong First Amendment position. What we would suggest in the bill is that you create a very clear provision that would limit it only to commercial entities and exclude not-for-profit speech. We recognize that there is a First Amendment issue here, and what we would like to do is to balance the First Amendment issue against the privacy interest in people receiving intrusive calls into their home and allow them to put their name into a database maintained at the federal level to opt out. It is a minimal burden on the speech. It again puts the burden on the individual to make the contact, to put their name into the database. We want to also ensure that if a commercial entity is making a call not to sell you something, not to have you rent something, but wants to make a call to you that is not commercial, even if it is a commercial entity, that that speech should be protected. So we want to make sure that that is changed in the bill before we can wholeheartedly support it. And additionally, in addition, we're also concerned about the creation of a database at the federal level. While we recognize that this is actually a very good solution and a good way to handle the problem, because as we've seen in the private sector, they've tried voluntary databases in terms of opt-out. The Direct Marketing Association has such a system. It doesn't work. It's not enforceable. It's a voluntary system. We're concerned about how the database would be used, and we would want to ensure that there are sufficient privacy and security safeguards on that database, not only to protect against unauthorized use, but also to make sure that there isn't any misuse of the information. One of the suggestions that we would have is that before a marketer could make a call, before there could be a commercial phone call, that they would need to, again, check the database to delete the phone numbers and possibly even allow the FCC or whatever organization is going to be managing the database to do the actual deletion. In addition, we would suggest that instead of having the marketer purchase the database, which may not even be necessary given how often these calls are made, but allow them to pay for the cost of allowing for the deletion to happen at the federal level. But again, normally we're very concerned about the creation of additional databases, so we would hope that we would continue to have some input into this suggestion. Again, any attempt to limit what information people have a right to send to others does raise very serious First Amendment questions, but we believe here that the privacy interest does outweigh the commercial interest in this area. In addition, we do support the additional limits on fax machines in terms of sending unsolicited advertising. We think that because of the burden that is placed on the individual who has to pay for the cost of the communication, that that then justifies the broader ban. Thank you very much. I'll be happy to answer any other questions.
4 minutes and 59 seconds. Good job. And our final witness of the first panel is Mr. Jack Shreve, who is public counsel for the state of Florida. Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee, my name is Jack Shreve. I am public counsel for the state of Florida and a member of the National Association of State Utility Consumer Advocates. NASUCA consists of 43 consumer advocate offices in 38 states and the District of Columbia. NASUCA represents consumers in utility matters before state, federal, regulatory commissions, and courts. We commend the subcommittee for holding this hearing on issues concerning telephone consumer protection and privacy rights. The Florida Office of the Public Counsel and the National Association of State Utility Consumer Advocates supports the passage of H.R. 1304 and H.R. 1305. While NASUCA welcomes the new information age, we believe restrictions must be put into place to protect consumers and to maintain the level of privacy they have come to know and expect. NASUCA endorses establishing telephone subscribers' privacy rights to avoid receiving telephone solicitations and establishing a single national database list of telephone subscribers who object to telephone solicitations. We fully support the idea of limiting the amount of unsolicited, burdensome, or junk calls through the use of any automatic dialing machine, telephone facsimile machine, and computer or electronic device. H.R. 1305 is absolutely essential for consumers to maintain their right to privacy. A national policy needs to be developed to prevent further burdensome deliberation of this matter on a state-by-state basis. NASUCA recommends that if caller ID is to be permitted, it must be offered at the very least with universal free per-call blocking. However, we also recognize additional adequate blocking may need to be implemented in situations where per-call blocking does not provide sufficient protection or privacy for individuals. Finally, NASUCA believes it is imperative that restrictions are placed on automatic number identification. As the new information age evolves, it is uncertain how this information will be applied for marketing purposes in the future. This legislation will provide consumers with safeguards to maintain their privacy rights. I think all of the points have really been made, but two things that I would like to urge you to look for in your deliberations with among yourselves and with your public. When I first started getting into this, particularly the caller ID area, I found that really the information that was being furnished to the Public Service Commission as well as to the general public and to the press was not adequate or full, and I think you really have to ferret out the information. One example there that I'd like to point out is that under the Bell proposals or the caller ID proposals that are out there that are put on the table and were put on the table before the Florida Public Service Commission do provide blocking for the caller to caller ID. However, this is very hard to see. That call blocking is provided if you make a local operator-assisted call or a credit card local call, so that an obscene caller or harassing caller can make the call, block his number off of the caller ID screen by paying a fee to Bell. That is inherent in the system that they are offering. This is not explained to the press and in most cases not explained to the public service commissions. The general public, as you go to the hearings, you'll find that they do not understand this. So that call blocking is not the issue, but whether or not the telephone company will receive a fee for that call blocking. The other item that I'd like to mention that Representative Rinaldi mentioned was call trace. In New Jersey, the New Jersey system is being used as the example around the country to sell caller ID. However, they failed to mention that call trace was put in place in New Jersey on a per call basis, which is exactly what you should have on the per call basis. Most of the companies, the telephone companies that are pushing caller ID fail to offer call trace on a per call basis, but offer it on a subscription or monthly basis only. This is not sufficient. In Florida, I petitioned for call trace after the caller ID had been requested by Southern Bell. Call trace is the most effective deterrent to obscene phone calls and harassing phone calls. This was borne out by backing by the entire law enforcement committee and community and the attorney generals. So call trace should be there whether or not you have caller ID and make it on a per call basis and not a subscription basis. That way it is available to every individual whenever they might receive an obscene or harassing phone call. Caller ID, generally speaking, is only going to be available to a very small percentage of the people that take it, and then even under the Bell systems or the systems that are being offered by the telephone companies, blocking is available and an obscene phone call can be made for a fee. Thank you.
Well, the gentleman's time has expired, and all time for witnesses on this first panel has expired. I just want to make one, just get one thing clarified before I recognize the gentleman from New Jersey. Mr. Cooper, on the subsequent panel, which we're going to hear from this morning, Mr. Brown of Illinois Bell will refer to the demonstrated effectiveness of caller ID in New Jersey as a basis for opposing the per-call blocking requirement contained in H.R. 1305. In your testimony, you outline a thorough refutation of the propaganda published by New Jersey Bell, purporting to prove that forced, unblockable caller ID is a great success. And you reference four formal proceedings in Pennsylvania, D.C., Maryland, and Delaware where these issues were argued. Can you provide us with some information about the reported success of the New Jersey experience and some details of findings from these proceedings?
Well, as I said in my testimony, I've been in 10 caller ID cases. Four of them have been in Bell Atlantic jurisdictions where you can't get away with press releases. You have to put the data in the case. And when you put the data in the case and you get the underlying data and you analyze it, you discover that this 50% reduction, which is one of the press releases that has been out numerous times, Mr. Rinaldo cited it, and then to his credit, he looked past it. If you look at that 50%, you can't find it. It's not based on a set of facts that is actually demonstrable subject to cross-examination. So what you will find in some cases is it's based on survey evidence in which more people said they had a reduction in their calls, their harassing, annoying calls, than ever claimed to have got them in the first place. And you discover it's an artifact of the structure of the questionnaire. When you go and look for this, the big reduction in annoyance call bureau, you discover that it's just being handled in a different way, so that the business office now deflects problems in a different direction, or they're expressed as automatic call traces. In the old days, you had trouble with call trace. It took weeks. Most people didn't go through it. Now you have automatic call trace. There's over 30,000 call traces a month in New Jersey. Now, call traces are supposed to be for serious problems. The number is there. It's a huge number. And the way I calculate it, there's been not much of a decline in the 2 years in those automatic call traces. Now, if people are getting bothersome calls, sufficiently bothersome to trace them, the problem hasn't gone away. So I submit, the difficulty is that this evidence has been put in these proceedings subject to protective cover. So you can only get at bits and pieces of it in the public, but in these proceedings, Delaware, the District of Columbia, Maryland, and Pennsylvania, when you get at the underlying data, you discover that the 50% number evaporates, and when those bodies have balanced, they've come to the same conclusion that Mr. Rinaldo has, that per-call blocking is in the public.
My time has expired. I recognize the gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Rinaldo.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I begin with my questions, I would like to request unanimous consent that Mr. Rottenberg, who testified that there was a Lou Harris poll, and he responded to that in his testimony, I would like to request that you submit that poll for the record. I think it would form an important and integral part of the record.
Mr. Rinaldo, it's attached to my testimony.
Oh, it is? Okay.
Yes.
I'd like to continue with Mr. Cooper. He was just speaking. And Mr. Cooper, I'm concerned that some unscrupulous merchants within the local exchange area may use caller ID to mask customer information they can then either sell or use themselves in ways that may lead to unsolicited and unwanted telemarketing efforts. For example, Bells already would like to obtain the right to utilize reverse directories so that they can sell access to their electronic listings so marketers can find out the name and addresses that belong to certain phone numbers. Well, with caller ID, you'd get the phone number, you'd look it up, and then that person can be subjected to all types of sales calls. Wouldn't per-call blocking provide consumers making purchases over the telephone with an effective protection against such practices?
I think it would, and I think there's two pieces of evidence, again, available in these cases that make it clear. One is that if you ask consumers what the largest source of annoying phone calls is, and there have been a series of studies, telemarketing beats the band. If there's noise and garbage on the network, it's telemarketing that they worry about. If you ask them on what kinds of calls don't they want to forward their number, it's business transactions. They don't want to call a used car salesman and have that number pop up on the used car salesman's or the car salesman's caller ID box. There's been a great debate in these cases over whether or not this is a useful way to compile a list. And frankly, I think it seems to me that if you call a BMW dealer expressing an interest in BMWs and he has your phone number, that becomes a very useful sort of market segmentation. You're obviously at the high end of the market. And he can sell his list that way. That's a valuable piece of information. The thing that caller ID does, as opposed to the phone book, is it transfers your number in the context of a personal transaction. And that becomes a more valuable piece of information. So if you look at the polls in these proceedings, the thing people worry about is giving their numbers up in commercial transactions. So I do believe that these will become another source. Local merchants don't use 800 numbers. This will become their source for compiling these kinds of lists which have the added value of saying, this person expressed this kind of interest, and my list is the BMW prospects list, with all those numbers I've gathered from caller ID.
Well, thank you very much. Ms. Goldman, in my view, calling parties have an expectation of privacy that must be balanced with the privacy right of the called party. Do you believe the free per-call blocking approach of H.R. 35 coupled with the option of a per-line block for those paying for unlisted numbers accomplishes this result?
Well, we absolutely support the per-call blocking option in this bill, and in fact, we've supported it in other similar bills in the House and the Senate that would amend federal law. The per-line blocking is a more difficult issue for us. A number of our affiliates have supported the per-line blocking option. I think it makes sense. It's very difficult, though, to imagine how you would allow certain per-line and per-call blocking options to work, but our main position is that we do absolutely support the right of people to be able to control personal information about themselves.
Well, how about a person with an unlisted number? They're paying a fee. Fee can range, I guess, over a dollar a month in some cases. Shouldn't they have a right to automatically have the option as to whether or not they want to protect that number? Presumably, that's the reason why they got the are paying for an unlisted number to begin with.
Well, clearly they have a stronger interest in protecting their privacy, but in our position, what we have determined is that the privacy interest of the person on the receiving end outweighs the privacy interest of the caller, which is why we place the burden in our position on the caller to have to block on a per-call basis.
I'd like to ask Mr. Rottenberg his opinion on that.
Well, our position, Mr. Rinaldo, differs only slightly from the ACLU's in that we don't see it as a zero-sum situation. The problem with the balancing analogy in the caller ID setting is that it assumes what the call receiver gives up in privacy, the person who makes the call gains. And it's not at all clear that that's the case. The call originator can choose not to disclose a number. The call recipient can choose not to accept calls from people who don't disclose numbers. And in fact, this is precisely the approach that's being followed in Europe, where they are struggling with the same issue of caller ID that we are in this country. And it's for this reason that it is not a zero-sum privacy situation, that we believe that callers' current expectation of privacy, which is that their number will not be disclosed unless they take an affirmative step, should be protected. But we certainly agree with you that a caller has a heightened privacy interest if he has selected unlisted or an unpublished service, because in that case, to disclose the numbers to undermine the service.
And the fees paid.
Absolutely.
Mr. Cooper, aren't there also constitutional rights at stake in the caller ID debate that we're currently going through? And what is your analysis of the proper balancing of those constitutional rights?
Well, I'm not a lawyer. The constitutional question has been engaged in one state, for instance, in Pennsylvania. And in my testimony, I make the following point. We might find that caller ID is constitutional. We find lots of things constitutional, but that doesn't make them good public policy. And so, for instance, in South Carolina, which is an example that's been used, the judge found that, in his opinion, the original court judge found that, in his opinion, the service did not violate the Constitution or the state's trap and trace law, but he put a cover on a letter on it which said, but if I could decide this on substance as opposed to constitutionality, it's crummy public policy and they ought to be blocking. So that, and I think this committee's decision to take a legislative approach is exactly right. This is a matter of public policy. Lots of things are, quote, constitutional, but they don't make good economic or public policy sense. So I don't even think we need to get to that level. And you might find differences of opinion here, but I think we all agree as a matter of public policy that there ought to be the ability for consumers to protect and defend their telephone numbers and keep them private.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
The gentleman's time has expired. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Barton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to ask some simple questions to Mr. Beard and Mr. Shreve. I'm a new member of the subcommittee, and I don't claim that I know all the buzzwords that you're talking about. Could you explain to me the difference in layman's terms between caller identification and call tracing? What's the Mr. Shreve or
yes,
Mr.
Sir.
Beard, either one?
And I think that's a large part of the confusion. I don't think there is enough information put out on the very basics of the whole program. And a caller ID, the person who takes the caller ID service would purchase the screen and then subscribe to the service and pay a monthly fee so that the calls coming in would appear on that screen, the numbers of the
this
caller.
This would be a screen in, at the recipient's home.
That's
I mean,
right.
The recipient
so,
phone number.
So that anyone that subscribed to that would have a caller ID screen, and the person who is making the call, their number would appear on the screen.
Now, what actually appears on the screen? Just the telephone number?
The telephone number appears on the screen.
Just the phone number.
Just the phone number. Now, the telephone number appears on the screen. Now, where I think a large part of the consuming public misunderstood from the first, press releases or that came out was, I think we all can agree, anyone that's responsible can say we would like to have a deterrent to obscene phone calls and harassing phone calls. However, under that plan, and it's not made obvious by the telephone companies, if I want to make an obscene phone call, even though you have the caller ID screen, I can block that call by making a local operator-assisted call or a credit card call, or using a cellular phone, or they also say go to the payphone down the street.
Now, I understand the payphone, but
right.
But is the other simply because the particular telephone company in Florida, they do it that way?
Or
the,
no, or the, I think that's going to be inherent, as I understand it, in all of the systems that would be offered at this point. But that is not made obvious. I frankly, when I first started getting into this, I had not taken a position, and I wanted to try and determine, okay, where do my statutory authority is to represent the citizens of the state of Florida, and I wanted to see where they were coming down. They never understood this. I don't think the press understood this. You had editorials all in favor of deterring obscene and harassing phone calls, but it was never made obvious to them that the question was not really whether to allow blocking or not, because blocking was available. Then when the people who had unlisted telephone numbers or unpublished telephone numbers started objecting to giving up their number, then you find that the telephone company tells them not to worry, all you have to do is make a credit card local call or an operator-assisted local call or use a cellular phone or go down the street to the payphone. The only problem is each one of those blocking opportunities or the opportunities that are available to the person with the unlisted phone number to block pays Southern Bell, in our case, either 75 cents or a dollar. So the question wasn't whether to block or not, it was whether to pay Southern Bell to block or not. Now that's the part of caller ID. Now call trace is where the number, and this is available and has been available in some places on a per call basis and some places on a subscription basis. Call trace is where I think I'm going to change this. Instead of me making the obscene phone call, I'm going to have somebody calling me making the obscene phone call. All right, if someone calls me and makes an obscene or harassing phone call, I can key in certain numbers or a certain code. That number will not appear on the screen anywhere, but it will be locked in with the telephone company and is available to law enforcement.
Now, I want to make sure I understand this.
Yes, sir.
My wife is at home in my hometown, and we don't get obscene phone calls. I don't want to mislead the committee. I'm not getting all kinds of perverted phone calls at my home. Basically, what I get is from people that call and they hang up. They just call and they don't. Maybe I'm not voting right. I don't know, but they but they hang up on me. But right. if it's a call trace, a call is received. Now, what do I have to do to trace that call under call trace?
All right. On call trace, and there are a couple of things available, but call trace, you would key in the key for that local telephone company. It would be usually three digits that you would punch on the phone.
When I get the call.
When you get the call.
Immediately.
When you hang up.
In our case, you punch *69 after they've hung up, and that number will be recorded at the central office, at the switch. You will not have access to that number at your home, but the telephone company will. You pick up the phone, you call the telephone company, you say, my number is such and such, I've just keyed in call trace because I've had an obscene phone call or I've had them hanging up on me repeatedly. I had a situation where I was getting a phone call every 30 minutes, hanging up. It came to find out that a computer had been programmed with a long telephone number and it was trying to interface with a modem. Unfortunately, I wasn't a modem. And it kept redialing, trying to get to me. And so I put call trace on it. It was at the office. And they backtracked through it. And in that instance, call trace was more effective than caller ID would have been because we found out what the problem was.
Well, now, what are, if I key in this three-digit code, what happens to that? Can I find out?
No.
No. You could contact either the telephone company or law enforcement, depending on how it's set up. And if it is an obscene or harassing phone call, that person can be prosecuted. But the person receiving the phone call would not have the phone number. And what law enforcement doesn't like about the caller ID, a part of it is vigilante justice. You would not have that telephone number, but it would be locked in and available. There's another thing that's available, too, is called call return, where you can just key in certain numbers and that return call is immediately returned to the party that made the call. If they called you and hung up, you could call back, talk to them, find out if they would take
you. I want
to
make sure I understand this.
All right.
Caller identification, there is a screen in the home, and the phone number is actually displayed on the screen.
Right. That's
caller
right.
Caller trace, you, the recipient of the phone call has to make an affirmative action to key in some sort of a code, and that identifies at the telephone company what that phone call is, but that's all. I mean, I don't know who it is.
That's right.
You know, so I can't do anything.
It operates just as a trace and trap would today. That number is located at the central office. The phone company has it. You, as the end user, do not.
Well, now, what do I do if I want to complain about that?
Well, what happens is just as in trap and trace today, one's not going to do it. It's going to have to be a repeated problem. You're going to have to go to law enforcement. They're going to have to investigate it, just as trap and trace would occur today from a law enforcement standpoint. It only streamlines the process in that you, in each instance, when it occurs, you can do something about it affirmatively. But you don't have that information, nor will you be given that either.
Well, let me ask one. The chairman has been very kind to me. I want to ask one final question. Why is there a right for somebody to invade my privacy anonymously? I don't understand that. I don't understand why we give, at least the tenet of this bill is that somebody who is trying to contact an individual has a right to do that anonymously. I don't understand that. Who wants to, Mr. Cooper?
Yeah, I've had this dialogue with a lot of PUC commissioners and others. The question is, the interesting thing is that the placing of a phone call you have defined as an invasion of your privacy. Most phone calls are not seen that way.
I understand
And the
that.
Vast majority are seen as efforts to communicate. You also use the knock on the door analogy. There is no right to invade your privacy. I can knock on your door. I have a right to walk up and knock on your door. I have a right to dial your number and ring it. You have a right to walk to the door and say, who is it? And if I don't respond, you say, I'm not interested, go away from my door, etc., and I may turn around and walk away. When I ring your phone, you pick it up, you have the same right to say, who is it? And if I don't answer, you say, I'm not going to talk to people who don't identify themselves, and you hang up. So that essentially, there's no right to doing anything anonymous. You control the exchange of information by saying, who is it? And when someone walks up to your door, if I'm wearing a gorilla mask or a Groucho Marx mask, I still have the right to knock on your door. And you look out and you say, I don't recognize that guy. Who is it? And so and that's a perfectly balanced right. And if I won't be responsive, now, if I stand there and keep knocking on your door, you can open the door and grab me and throw me down the street, which is a bit of vigilante justice, or you could call the police and say, I got somebody over here trespassing and harassing me, and I think that's the way law enforcement would rather have you deal with it, rather than go out and grab the guy. Well, that's exactly the situation with caller ID. Suppose your wife gets the number on the box. What do you want her to do with it?
We're going to call the local police or whoever the local authorities are.
You're not going to have her open the door and get in a fight with the guy. That's exactly the point. Well, call trace does that for you. You get a trace, you call the police, and you invoke the authorities. So caller ID really hasn't given you a great deal in your situation where you have this problem.
It gives me more than I have now, which is nothing. I yield back to the chairman. The
gentleman's time has expired. I have to just ask a couple of questions of this panel before we complete the this group and then move on quickly to the last panel. Mr. Shreve, quickly, please. Again, the next panel, one witness will suggest that a federally mandated blocking requirement is unnecessary and preemptive, and that each state should decide the appropriate form of caller ID. In your testimony, you discussed the current environment of state regulation. Do you believe that the current patchwork quilt of differing state laws and regulations can adequately protect the privacy interests of makers of phone calls?
I think in this situation, and I think all of you have been raising a balance, that you're looking for something here that will give us a balance and try and give the best of all worlds to everyone. Without even carrying it all the way to a state-by-state basis, in our state, and I don't think this is going to happen, but it is possible, and we have been concerned about it, and law enforcement has been concerned about it. In our state, Southern Bell offered the caller ID without any blocking, except for that by credit card calls or
is federal legislation necessary? That's all I need to know. Please, I have to move on quickly.
I think so, and my reason is because Centel, on the other hand, within our state, offered it a different way. If you come up within a state with two different types of proposals or approvals, then you're going to have a real problem for law enforcement.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Ms. Goldman, in your testimony, you support the establishment of a national do not call list and state that opt-out databases where people can elect not to be on a list provide an appropriate balance between the legitimate privacy rights of the individual and the societal value of receiving commercial solicitation. You also highlight the fact that the Direct Marketing Association, which will testify on the next panel, operates a telephone and mail preference service of computerized lists of people who have contacted the association to request that their names be removed from telephone and mailing lists. While the Direct Marketing Association encourages member companies to purchase and abide by the list, what do you feel are the shortcomings or problems of the Direct Marketing Association approach? Very quickly, please.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I say in my statement that while DMA has such a list, it is a voluntary list, voluntary to their members and certain non-members. They can choose to use it if they want. It is unenforceable. So when a person decides that they want to remove their name from a mailing list or a telemarketing list, they can put it on the DMA's list. There is no assurance that it will actually keep them from being called.
Okay. So it's lack of enforceability, it's strictly voluntary.
Absolutely.
And there's no guarantee that the individual is going to be protected.
Absolutely.
And finally, Mr. Beard, can you tell the committee how many complaints per month have been received by the Florida Division of Consumer Services regarding problems from unsolicited calls? In your testimony, you note that Florida recently passed a statute that prohibits telephone solicitors from calling consumers who are registered on a list of persons who do not wish to receive telemarketing calls. Can you provide the committee, you or Mr. Shreve, with details about the success of this opt-out list in Florida? Either one of you.
I don't have a specific number. The complaints are growing. The enforceability is tough. I would agree with what she said.
Okay. If for the record, Mr. Shreve, working with Mr. Beard, if you could provide that,
Father, be happy to.
It would be enormously helpful to us. I apologize to the panel. You've been very good and constructive in your presentations. We're going to be working closely with you. There's some tension that exists on this panel, although not as much as with the next panel. Amongst all of you, we're going to have to work closely if we're going to construct a bill, because we are going to move and move quickly this year. Thank you all very, very much. Our next panel is Mr. Donald McKenzie, president of 9X Information Resources Company, Mr. Richard Barton, executive director for the Direct Marketing Association, Mr. Richard H. Brown, president of Illinois Bell, Mr. Michael J. Frawley, president of Gold Coast Paging Incorporated. All right, gentlemen, I very much appreciate your cooperation and participation in our hearing today. Again, we're under some time constraints. If you could keep your opening statements down to 5 minutes, it would still leave us with 15 minutes or so to go through a question and answer period. So we'll begin with you, Mr. Brown, if we could. Whenever you feel comfortable, please begin. If you could move the microphone up a little bit closer, I think that could be helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee. I'm delighted to be here. My name is Dick Brown, and I'm the president of Illinois Bell. Illinois Bell and Ameritech opposed federal caller ID legislation because it would curtail discussion on the issues at the state level at this time. Public utility commissions throughout the country are already exploring how to best offer caller ID in their respective jurisdictions. The state commissions are responding to the needs of their constituents in different and sometimes experimental ways. Such experimentation would be stifled by preemptive federal regulation at this time. Illinois Bell recently filed for permission to offer caller ID without blocking. The Illinois Commerce Commission staff has since recommended that our proposal be adopted on a 2-year trial. I might add that another telephone company, Centel in Illinois, has offered to offer this service on a per-call blocking basis, and the staff recommendation at this time is to allow that trial to also take place in concert with ours on a 2-year trial basis. The proposed federal legislation would preempt the Illinois Commerce Commission's efforts at this point. There's no doubt about the public's interest in caller ID. Though it is not yet available in Illinois, our customers very seriously expressed a great interest in caller ID, more than in any other new service we offer. Our research indicates why. According to a survey we conducted last August, nearly 30% of Illinois Bell residents' customers told us they had received one or more obscene telephone call in the last 12 months. That translates to more than 1 million Illinois residential customers receiving obscene calls. More than 10% of our customers had received harassing and threatening telephone calls, and that translates to more than 300,000. The most serious complaints are referred to our annoyance call bureau. The number of calls the Bureau handles rose 8% last year to nearly 66,000. 90% of Illinois Bell's customers in our surveys of interviews said they had received problem calls within the last year. Not surprisingly, many were unsolicited telemarketing calls. There's a lot of concern that businesses have about misusing caller ID and to assemble database files on customers. However, businesses do not do that today, rather, without the fact that caller ID is in place, and caller ID can actually protect customers from inconvenient business calls. Other services, such as call trace, as was mentioned, do not provide the same benefits and are not realistic substitutes, in my estimation, for caller ID. For example, poison control centers and suicide hotlines need immediate access to callers' telephone numbers to save lives. For the vast majority of our customers, caller ID without blocking is no more intrusive than automobile license plates. Our customers view this service as giving the called party parity with the person being called. Illinois Bell recognizes that certain groups, such as domestic violence shelters, undercover law enforcement, and so forth, need to retain their anonymity when placing some of their phone calls, and we're working very closely with such groups. Many value the benefits of caller ID. They are satisfied with the technological alternatives we have developed to guarantee anonymity to them. It's important to address the needs of such groups creatively, but not to do so by limiting new technological developments. It's also important to draw a distinction between the right to privacy and a right to anonymity. We support everyone's right to privacy and believe that caller ID can help ensure that right. We do not believe that anyone has the right to harass or threaten other people by hiding behind the mask of anonymity. Federal legislation mandating blocking would hamstring the effectiveness of caller ID. Illinois Bell and Ameritech unequivocally favor caller ID without blocking, with accommodations for groups with legitimate needs for anonymity. Regulatory commissions in Illinois, Indiana, and Ohio in our region are evaluating proposals to offer the service. It is the most effective method for combating telephone abuse. We believe that every state should continue to be free to decide how to regulate caller ID for its citizens. Where needs vary, rulings may differ. However, there is no need to mandate federal restrictions at this juncture. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Brown, very much. Our next witness is Mr. Richard Barton, Executive Director of the Direct Marketing Association here.
Mr. Chairman, it's a pleasure to be here. We appreciate your inviting us to testify on these very important issues and very important bills. I represent the Direct Marketing Association, which is an association of approximately 3,000 domestic companies that deal in all forms of direct marketing, including primarily mail and telephone. And so these issues are very important to us. I want to emphasize at the beginning, as has been touched on by the previous panel, that this association has been very deeply dedicated to the concept of self-regulation to the extent as possible, but also to enlightened and good regulation on a federal or state level when it is necessary. And therefore, we approach the bills you have here with a little bit of a mixed feeling, and I'll explain that to you as we move along. Last year, we had very good working relationships with you and your staff and came out with a bill on fax and automatic dialing machines that we thought was a good bill, which is the kind of good regulation that we're talking about, trying to get at specific problems that the technology created and to prevent those problems from happening. And the bill, which was finally agreed to but never passed and sent to the President, did things like prohibiting sequential dialing for ad ramps, established automatic disconnect rules, required identification of the calling parties on pre-recorded messages, prohibited those machines from calling critical numbers such as hospitals and things of that nature. And we thought that was a good bill, and still think it's a good bill, so those aspects of H.R. 1304 that are still there, we support. However, we were a little bit surprised, and I have to say dismayed, when the new bill came out, and we have found that the bill itself and its intention has gone far broader than trying to solve specific problems that a technology has created. And we're now into the rather murky area of either banning or significantly regulating with civil penalties unsolicited phone calls made not by machines but made by live operators. And we think we have to go look very carefully at this before we decide that we can move ahead with the bill. Our specific problems in terms of the unsolicited phone calls and the having to run by a federally maintained list of do not call lie in two or three different areas. First, we're concerned about its scope of coverage through the definition of what telephone solicitations is. It covers basically commercial solicitations, though, as I'll say in a second, it's not exclusively commercial. It says that if you're going to make a call to sell goods and services, etc., then you have to run it by a national list. But it's not content neutral. In the first place, we do not include fundraising calls. We do not include political calls asking people to vote. We do not include surveys in this, and there's no indication anywhere that, in fact, these calls are any less intrusive or less annoying to people than the calls that you do require follow this. And I think that this is a serious problem we need to look at. It is not a content-neutral bill. You specifically say here that for one reason or another that we have to subject to federal regulation unsolicited calls of a particular nature but not unsolicited calls of another nature. And I think that we need more proof that, in fact, those calls that are not included in this bill are, for some reason or other, not as intrusive. The second problem is that this does not include now any recognition of a pre-existing relationship. Therefore, if I have subscribed to a magazine for 50 years and somebody finds my subscription is about to expire, under this bill, I could not be called by Time Inc. or New Republic and asked if I wanted to subscribe unless this company ran the calls by this national do not call list. Which brings us to the final thing. We maintain a national do not call list too, and one of our real concerns is that, as it's been pointed out here, it is imperfect. We're trying to make it more and more perfect, but these lists are by nature imperfect, and we believe that self-regulation, strongly pushed, would be better than having to subject literally thousands of national and local callers to federal penalties if they call someone who is on this list when the list itself we think is not going to be a very, very good list in the first place. I will continue on about 1304 if we'd like to discuss any questions, but I would like to go to the ANI caller identification for just a moment, since this is a big concentration. We have supported...
Mr. Barton, I'm sorry, your 5 minutes are up. I apologize to you.
Very well. Well, we support the concepts with one exception in our testimony, and we agree with caller blocking.
Okay, good. Thank you, sir. Our next witness is Mr. Michael Frawley, who is the president of Gold Coast Paging here from Miami Lakes, Florida. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee. You have my statement for the record. Gold Coast Paging and Telecater would like to thank you for this opportunity to express our views, and we wholeheartedly support 1304. And Chairman Markey and Congressman Manali, we'd like to thank you for your leadership in bringing this to fruition here. My name is Michael Frawley, and I'm the president of Gold Coast Paging in Southeast Florida and have been in the communications business for 34 years. I am presently a member and a director of Telecater, our trade association with over 650 members, representing paging and cellular subscribers to the tune of over 15 million in the United States. I'm also very active in our Southeastern Radio Common Carrier Association. I have been a director of the Florida Radio Telephone Association for the past 13 years. And it's indeed a pleasure to sit on this side of the table with some of my colleagues from the Florida Public Service Commission instead of the other side. In the 34 years that I've been in the telecommunications business, my objective every day when I come to work is one thing, and one thing only, and that is to provide service to the public. In 34 years since I graduated from high school, that's the only thing I've known. And I point that out in deference to the folks that, you know, might be in a retail operation and come to work every day to make a profit on a certain item, or a wholesaler who probably works on a lesser profit and more volume, or a politician whose objective is whatever it is while you come to work. But I come to work every day to give service. And it's really rough when you come to work every day with the objective of giving service when you have outside influences that can alter that objective. When I say outside influences, I'm talking about auto dialers that seize up our blocks of numbers. For example, I have 10,000 numbers in a 363 exchange, and if an auto dialer gets into that 363 exchange and attacks numbers in 100 groups, it can tie up that exchange and impede the service to all of my customers, to the Coast Guard, to national defense organizations, police, fire department, hospitals, doctors, you name it. They're all affected. Now, this has been a problem for many years. As a matter of fact, back in 1987, we convinced the FCC to issue a public notice warning telemarketing firms that numbers assigned to paging and cellular subscribers should be avoided. And indeed, Telecater pointed out the simple solution would be to have these lists excluded from the auto dialers completely. Mr. Chairman, it's 4 years later and the problem persists. The falsing of these blocks of numbers causes confusion to our customers, and it causes a tremendous expense to the radio common carriers when customers call in and say, my beeper isn't working or it's falsing and we have to exchange it. We're looking at an expensive proposition to go out and exchange it and send it into our repair shop to be looked at when it indeed is no trouble. I don't believe it helps the telemarketing firms either to get into a block of cellular or paging numbers if they have an objective to sell whatever their product is. It certainly doesn't help them to come into a paging organization and just go down the list. They're just wasting their time as well as confusing our customers and hurting us. And sometimes these efforts are very, very traumatic. For example, we have a Life Page program, which is a Telecater program where we provide free service to recipients of heart and liver transplants. And these folks rely and they wait for a beep to see if an organ has been found. This is a service that we provide at no cost to these folks. And it's pretty traumatic to have a beep from some telemarketing firm get their hopes up that maybe they found the liver that I need for my very existence or my life. And to avoid confusion, the way we work this is we give them a free beeper, but only the transplant coordinator and the transplant center have the number. Nobody else has that person's number. Last week in my shop, a fellow came in and rented a beeper from us, and he was the parent of one of the victims of the Gainesville murder. And the only reason he's carrying that beeper is because the police in Gainesville have asked him to do so. They for some reason want to beep him, and he thinks in the near future. And I think it would be extremely traumatic in the same situation for that guy to get a beep. He cried in my office, okay? It would be traumatic for this guy to get a beep thinking, oh my God, this is it, and have some telemarketing person. We just recently had a doctor who was with one of his patients on his deathbed, and he was with the family members, and a voice beeper went off and tried to telemarket some kind of a product, and the doctor was very upset and wrote this letter. And with your permission, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to submit this letter as an attachment to my testimony. Thank you. And I'm going to expedite this because I know we're in a hurry. I would like to point out that our customers pay for this kind of a service. Our customers in cellular, as you know, pay for airtime, and many paging subscribers also pay for usage over a certain amount. And we think it's unfair that we're being forced, or our customers are being forced, to underwrite the cost of unwanted calls generated by auto dialers.
Mr. Frawley, I hate to give you the news, but I'm afraid your time has expired. Do you have any final comments you want to make?
Yes, I just would wind up by saying we wholeheartedly support 1304, and we also support 1305, which concerns the offering of caller ID services. However, we'd like to clarify that paging is a permitted use of caller ID capability under the proposed legislation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Frawley. And our final witness, Mr. Donald McKenzie, is the president of 9X Information Resources Company. Welcome, Mr. McKenzie.
Thank you, Chairman Markey and subcommittee members. I am president of 9X Information Resources Company and chairman of the Yellow Pages Publishers Association's Public Policy Committee. I'm testifying today on behalf of the association. I wish to thank you for the opportunity of appearing before the subcommittee today to discuss H.R. 1305 and the increasingly important use of consumer privacy in connection with, with new telecommunications services. The Yellow Pages Publishers Association, otherwise known as YPPA, is a trade group formed in 1988 that represents 140 publisher members who produce more than 90% of the Yellow Page directories in the United States. Today, our industry is in the forefront of information technology with the advent of the Talking Yellow Pages. Talking Yellow Pages services offer everything from weather and stock quotes to topical additions to printed advertising messages and appear in hundreds of classified directories across the country. It's a rapidly expanding business and is expected in the near future to be virtually as universal as the traditional Yellow Pages. This new and unique aspect of Yellow Pages has fostered a sincere and pervasive concern throughout the industry for maintaining the goodwill of our customers. The industry has long been guided by widespread recognition of the need to be sensitive to consumer interests. Certainly, a part of those interests involve the legitimate privacy expectations of its users. It was against this backdrop that YPPA decided last year to adopt its privacy protection policy that we believe is consistent with the goals and objectives of the ANI provisions of H.R. 1305. As does H.R. 1305, YPPA's policy requires a caller's consent before any personal information can be sold to a third party or used for any purpose other than that for which the call was made. Although we encourage all information businesses to adopt the same kind of internal pro-consumer policies, we nonetheless believe that H.R. 1305 is necessary to ensure consumers that their privacy will not be subject just to ad hoc protection. Finally, YPPA believes it is crucially important that policymakers and business leaders alike recognize that identical privacy issues are raised when customer proprietary information is gathered by means other than the telephone network. The restrictions in H.R. 1305 are a strong first step. The next step is to ensure that similar restrictions govern the customer information collection activities in all areas of the marketplace. Again, Mr. Chairman, YPPA strongly endorses the ANI provisions of 1305 and applaud your efforts in this area. As an organization interested in protecting consumer privacy, we pledge to work with you. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. McKenzie, very much, and we thank all of you for your testimony. Let me recognize myself for a quick round, and then we'll move down to the other members. Mr. Brown, call trace allows the called party to automatically trace any incoming call and have that number stored in the telephone company's central office switch. That number can then be relayed to the proper authorities, even if the harassing caller blocked his or her number. In essence, this service can catch the obscene breather while giving the innocent callers the right to breathe easier because their unlisted numbers are not being divulged to the world when they call. As you know, there are other technologies and services such as Return Call, which allow you to call back the last person who called you and to confront them, and a Block the Blocker technology that will reject any call to your home phone from someone blocking their phone number. Now, all of these technologies avail the public of the opportunity to combat the same problem calls that you purport is the rationale for offering caller ID without blocking. Yet these technologies can catch the bad guys while also protecting the legitimate privacy rights of people who have unlisted numbers. How does Illinois Bell propose to balance the legitimate rights of Illinois residents with unlisted telephone numbers? In some states, this is 10, 20, 30% of the population. If it does not offer them an opportunity to continue to protect their right to disclose their number.
Chairman Markey, that's a good question. It has several parts. Let me come at it this way. Somebody mentioned earlier in the panel about offering call trace. I believe that call trace should certainly be offered when any company offers the product of caller ID. One of the dilemmas we have, and we have not offered call trace yet. Illinois Bell has not offered caller ID. We hope to get approval on both before year ends. But on call trace, we've been cautioned by the Chicago Police Department and other police departments that they simply will not be able to handle the volume of customer requests on a trace basis when that service goes in. In fact, there are police departments in states that have call trace today that severely limit the critical condition under which they'll even get involved because they've got more important things to do. So caller ID picks up for a mass of people who suffer from the kinds of problems I outlined with calling abuse, where call trace is only going to get the assistance of the police, I believe, in extreme cases.
I'll be glad to yield.
You know, that was an interesting response you gave. Do you mean that since the police are too busy, that with caller ID, the individual should then take the law in his own hands?
Well, Congressman, it's a touchy issue, but we found when we looked at what kinds of calls are customers getting that they don't want. Calling and hanging up is one of the most common examples. Teenagers calling one another. We find that families with teenage children are subject because of their kids to this sort of prankster calling or, as a parent would see it, harassing calling. And I think that there are conditions here where a party in a residence could get involved knowing the number calling them, where the police would simply say, well, I'd like to help you, I've got more important things to do. And they've got some very serious life-threatening situations, I think, that they'd, as the pure logistics of the situation, would force them to attend to first. We have had last year, we estimate, 200,000 calls made to our offices from people who are seeking help on unwanted calls. Now, the 66,000 calls I mentioned that went to our annoying call bureau are the most severe cases, and of that, you know, probably less than that, some number substantially less than that, could even be accommodated by police.
Well, let me follow up and try to complete my round quickly. So then, is Illinois Bell going to give to those subscribers with unlisted telephone numbers that service with that service free of charge if you implement a caller ID without blocking system, since in large measure now each one of their calls will be in the hands of whomever they called, thereby vitiating the entire purpose of their unlisted telephone number?
Mr. Chairman, we have no plans to do that. We, ironically, in talking with New Jersey people, and they're perhaps the only laboratory for this of any substantial period of time, my understanding is that many of the people who have subscribed to caller ID also have unlisted telephone numbers, and basically they've gotten those unlisted telephone numbers in many cases because they have been victims of harassing or otherwise unwanted calls. So they are subscribers of both. So we would continue to charge, as we presently plan to do it, for an unlisted number, which keeps the number out of the telephone directory as a commitment, the address and the telephone number, and also charge for caller ID.
So they have to pay more for what they already have today?
Well, I think what they would want would be the right to know who calls their home in the privacy of their home. So I don't see it as a conflict. Now, you know, we're not there yet, and continued public hearings on the issue have to take place.
Well, in your testimony, you implored this committee not to destroy caller ID with federally mandated blocking. I don't believe that the free per-call blocking required in this legislation will destroy or even decrease, for that matter, the value or effectiveness of the caller ID service. I feel that quite strongly. I've been working with the minority in terms of trying to develop legislation that can accomplish that goal while not destroying the value of caller ID. I think the technology is out there that makes it possible for us to accomplish those goals, and I would regret if this discussion deteriorated to a point where we wound up with polarized positions on an issue which clearly we're going to have to reconcile the differences, and that is the intention of the subcommittee.
We certainly want to work with you, Mr. Chairman, and I think, if I may say so, the area of the legislation, the broad area, addresses a serious need in this country, and I support the continued look at this.
Thank you. My time has expired. I recognize the gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Rinaldo.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, let me say at the outset that I, too, want to work with you and certainly with the affected parties in crafting the kind of legislation that will serve the best interests of the consumers of this country. As you know, Mr. Brown, in many states, a significant percentage of telephone subscribers have unlisted numbers. In my home state of New Jersey, it's roughly one-third. In California, for example, it's over 50%. And given the fact that these people pay a pretty hefty fee, when you come right down to a monthly charge in most cases, to have those unlisted numbers, clearly, in my mind, no matter how much you for ID, caller ID, those individuals have a strong desire for an expectation of privacy, and they're paying for it. And I feel that under those conditions, we have to take a careful look at that, because unrestricted caller ID would put the anonymous nature of those calls at risk. So when you say, you know, you're opposed to it, I think you have to respond to that concern. And I would hope you would agree to look into that and feel that this committee has an obligation as public servants to come up with a public policy that's fair to people who pay a fee. And, you know, I can't buy the argument that they're paying one fee and we'll have per call blocking, let them pay another fee to block the call. I mean, we've got to look at this with some degree of compassion.
We will continue to work with you, Mr. Congressman.
All right. You also stated in your testimony that you believe that unrestricted caller ID would be the best model for adopting in your state of Illinois. Why have you discounted the example of other jurisdictions in which some form of blocking is available, yet there still is significant subscriber interest in the service.
Well, it's true that if you look at the states to date, it's a pretty mixed bag. Almost as many, as I recall, of the states have initiated some form of blocking, usually on a per-call basis, as have been states where they have said, let's try the service without blocking. So why the difference? And even some telephone companies are proposing a blocking method. And I think this is to try to have laboratories take shape that can really get at the issue of how much of this concern is founded and how much of this concern is unfounded. And the issue of privacy gets widely debated, but we really line up on the side of the customer who, in the privacy of their home, really has a right to know who's trying to reach them. And I think that's what caller ID without blocking does. Interestingly, my understanding of the New Jersey experience, although I come with a lot of data from Illinois, is that just the offering of a service, caller ID, without blocking, even though it's accepted as a service and paid for on a subscription basis by less than 10% of the subscribers, has had a tremendously positive effect on the population at large, because if I have a deleterious motive in mind in calling you, I'm not really sure whether you have caller ID without blocking or not. And so the benefits get spread across the entire society.
Except that there are a lot of people in a lot of circumstances that really mitigate against the use of caller ID without blocking. For example, the undercover agent who is operating out of a home who doesn't want that number to be given away. The person in a case that I recounted yesterday, an individual who was utilizing the telephone to comparison shop. And someone, an unscrupulous merchant, in effect, got a hold of this lady's number and harassed her to death to try and get her to buy the product. The individual who makes a slip of the finger in the wrong phone call, and perhaps that woman then is subjected to harassment by the person who gets that number. And the fact that people, what makes it even more dangerous without blocking is that once people have the number, certainly the technology is there, and you want to offer the service to give them the address also. So I think it's something that has to be handled judiciously and carefully, and that's what we're trying to do, and I would hope that you would cooperate with us in that effort.
We will certainly cooperate. One comment, Congressman Rinaldo.
Sure.
We have been working very hard, in Illinois Bell in particular, to visit with stakeholder groups who have concerns about a no-blocking posture. And we have interviewed over 500 such people, organizations, and agencies. We've had public hearings across the state of Illinois involving hundreds of people who have come to testify. And the fact is that to date, there is not a sheriff's department in Illinois or a police department that has publicly opposed caller ID without blocking. Once people understand the abilities they have to work with technology for that kind of protection, it seems to work. And the other forgotten element here, I think, is small business. In the Ameritech region, we have 800,000 small business customers. And I think this is a big part of America's future. And I think the small business advantages to caller ID without blocking far outweigh the disadvantages these businesses would experience. Now, certainly having the service in and working and seeing how this really comes to be is essential before I think final legislation can be responsibly undertaken, but we want to work with you.
Well, I'm very familiar with it, having come from New Jersey. I also just took a look at the poll that was mentioned by one of the panelists on the in the last panel. And it's interesting that 43% feel that you shouldn't even be allowed to sell it. And when they were asked, do you feel this new service should be freely available, or that it should be regulated by law, or that it should be banned completely? In response to that question, 55% said caller ID should be regulated by law, 25% said caller ID should be banned completely, and 17% said caller ID should be freely available. And that's by a very respected pollster, Lou Harris. So I think there is substantial evidence, both substantive and anecdotal, to show that at least, in my view, this committee is on the right track.
And I think, Congressman, you're right in the sense that our own research would have some very different conclusions. So it just reinforces, I think, the need to take a good look at this.
Your research may be a little more driven by economic considerations also.
The gentleman's time has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Barton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I ask unanimous consent that Congressman Bliley's opening statement be included in the record.
Without objection, it will be included in the record at the appropriate point.
I have several, again, factual questions. Primarily, they're going to be to Mr. Brown because you're with the Bell Telephone Company. Is it technically possible to differentiate in your switching and to some of the concerns about residential telephone callers calling commercial phone numbers that then the commercial number has caller ID and uses this for business purposes? Could you allow residential caller ID without allowing commercial caller ID? Is that possible? Could you differentiate that way?
Well, I'll give a qualified answer, Congressman, because I'm an English major, not an engineer, but I think that's possible to do. And it would restrict for a universe of our consumer base, for our telephone base, the service at hand. But I subject to verification with my engineers, I think that's doable.
All right, let me ask another question. To try to address some of the concerns that the chairman, Mr. Markey, asked, when somebody with an unlisted number calls let's say they call another unlisted number, that has caller ID, would it be technically possible when the call is placed before it rings for a little telephone voice to come on and say, the number you are calling has caller ID? And that way, if the person didn't want the person they were calling to know that they were calling, they could hang up. Is that technically possible?
Well, you're really pushing me to the limit. I have to say, I have confidence that that's probably something that our engineers in this industry could work out. I don't think that's what we want to do, and I don't think that's what the American people want, at least in this state of Illinois. But subject to verification, I think that sort of technology.
Well, they always tell me when I use my credit card call, they thank me for using, you know, the credit card number that I the service. They, right. They always thank me very politely. So, if it's possible to thank me before that kind of a call goes through, I just sitting here thinking it might be possible to let the person know that the person they were calling had caller ID, and that way if the person making the call didn't want them to know, they could terminate the telephone call. So again, trying to alleviate some of the problems.
Congressman, in response to that also, I think probably as I think through who would use that or like to see that feature, I think the bad guys would win out. You also need to realize, and you probably do, that even with block to block, some of this technology isn't going to be usable ubiquitously for a number of years. So, you know, I'd have to qualify my technological yes with a question mark on the time frame.
Okay. And final question. In all of your, I think you make an excellent point when you say various states are approaching this problem in different ways. And it is probably inappropriate at this time for the Congress to take a national perspective. Having said that, if a state takes a different approach, let's say Illinois takes a different approach than Indiana, how do you handle interstate telephone calls if joining states, or for that matter, California takes a different approach? How would you handle caller identification in Illinois if California does it differently?
Well, you raise an excellent issue, and at the interstate level or the federal level, I think this is an issue that really has to be carefully looked at by the Federal Communications Commission, because as a panelist in the earlier panel mentioned, while it's good to have states have laboratories to assess the caller ID issue, blocking versus non-blocking, there's got to be some federal coordination. I don't have the answer for that, but it clearly needs to be addressed. I think there are ways to have different states handle this issue in different ways and still have a unilateral federal policy exist.
Okay, I thank the chairman. The
gentleman's time has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Bilirakis.
Thank you, Mr. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I apologize to you and to all of our witnesses for my late arrival. Right down the hall, the Veterans Committee is holding a hearing on medical care and the 140 deaths that occurred in the North Chicago Medical Center over a period of 10 months, and I just felt I had to stay there. I want to welcome Commissioner Baird and Mr. Frawley, who are here from Florida. Mr. Shreve, I believe, has left. Just basically maybe one question, one or two questions, Mr. Frawley, if I may. The 1990 Florida bill, the Telephone Solicitation Act, which was passed last year, in your opinion, how is that working at this point in time? How effective is it? I realize we don't have very long history on it.
I'm not really sure how that's working. I think we you know, when you deal with telemarketers, you're not always dealing with people that know what's going on in Tallahassee or for that matter in Washington, and many of them just indiscriminately attack blocks of numbers. We haven't had any real serious threat with manual telemarketer. Well, of course, if a manual telemarketer called and he got a beeper number, he'd know something was wrong. He'd go elsewhere. We have had problems, though, with dial-up machines blocking up our numbers, and we come in at 9 o'clock in the morning and find our switch locked up, and the telephone company and ourselves working together can't figure out why it happened, and we can only assume it was a block of auto dialers. We have no proof of it.
I see. So that could have happened. These may have been callers who were calling people who were not registered in accordance with the Florida bill. Is that correct?
That's correct.
How about the jurisdiction over interstate calling? Do you have any answer on that, insofar as that legislation goes?
No, I thought that was a great question for Mr. Barton, and I frankly hadn't thought about it.
That in itself might, I'll talk to Commissioner Baird about it, but that in itself would be enough of a reason to necessitate the federal legislation, I would imagine.
The only thing I would mention is we Telecater folks and the Florida Radio Telephone Association are in the business of paging. We have 10 million pagers in the country, and many of those pagers are numeric display pagers. And the very purpose of it is a person gets a page or so that somebody can call in the number to be dialed back. That's exactly the service they're buying. So we do have to distinguish paging apart from a landline telephone.
That's a good point. All right, thank you, Mr. Frawley. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Well, although I would note that in conclusion, there are several issues that have as yet been as fully probed as we would like, and Mr. McKenzie, Mr. Barton, and others, I'm sure, would like to have had opportunities to expand their comments. Mr. Barton, I would have loved to have explored with you the voluntary nature of the compliance and the protection of individuals in our country and the economically driven, again, interest which direct marketers have in basically ignoring privacy rights in the pursuit of a buck. And that's a serious tension that oftentimes it's difficult for private sector individuals to monitor. It's not that there aren't many good people in the direct marketing area. It's that 10 or 15% of the scam artists, the fly-by-night people, can come in and basically, without any real protection, do some serious damage to the privacy rights of Americans and impugn an entire industry's reputation because of the lack of full protection. And so right down the line is a whole series of additional questions which we would love to be able to explore with you, but we're under a time constraint because we committed to empty this room out for the next event. These are two very important bills, two very important issues, and this is how technology touches people in their homes. This is the real life interaction with the technology, and as a result, there's tremendous consumer interest in the subject, and we do intend on moving forward. We want to be informed with regard to the perspectives of each of you as we're moving forward, but we are going to move forward. So please stay close to us in terms of your interaction so that we can fully incorporate all of your legitimate concerns in the legislation. We thank you all very, very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate
thank you.
It. The hearing is adjourned, and we ask each of you, if you could, to please leave the room as quickly as possible so they can set up for the next hearing. Thank you.
You should thank Chairman Beard from Florida.
That concludes our coverage of this House Energy and Commerce Subcommittee hearing on telephone solicitation. For more information, write to the subcommittee at 316 House Annex No. 2 in Washington, D.C. The zip code is 20510. Coming up next on C-SPAN, a symposium on humor and the Ford presidency.